Hello children, last class we saw about the bacterial infections or the bacterial diseases caused in human beings. Today we will see viral infections and some protozoan infections and fungal infections. First of all, we will see viral infection in human health and diseases. The same chapter guys, it's a continuation of the chapter. Many viruses also cause diseases in human beings. This rhinoviruses, it's one such group of viruses. They cause the most infectious human ailment is nothing but the common cold. See, rhinoviruses, you have in this, it can be categorized A, B, C. All these group of viruses A, B, C, all they're supposed to cause only common cold. That you know, you're familiar with common cold. They infect the nose and the respiratory passage or the trachea, but not the lungs. Sometimes that is upper tract, respiratory tract infection. Sometimes they may affect the lower tract infections, that is the lungs also. Sometimes we'll see the symptoms. Already, whenever you have common cold, the normal symptoms are nasal congestion, that is, the nasal passages will have swelling with excess fluid and mucus, that is because of the virus. So, they have a they will not be able to some kind of uncomfort they have in the nasal passage and discharge, sore throat, that is nothing but the pain in the throat, and hoarseness, that is the voice, change in the voice, they will not be able to speak, swelling, that is because of the infection, cough, headache and tiredness, that will last for 3 to 4 days. It's not very dangerous. It can be cured, but it's easily communicable. A person will easily transmit to a healthy person. And you know the mode of transmission, nothing but droplets resulting from cough or sneezes of an infected person, or either inhaled directly, then it may affect a healthy person, or transmitted through contaminated objects such as pens, books, cups, door knobs, and cause infection in a healthy person. So, you have to be very careful because easily it spreads. This is about the virus. Let's have a picture of the rhinoviruses. I said A, B, C can be categorized into A, B, C. This is a picture of rhinoviruses. Next, we'll see about the protozoans. Next, we'll see about the protozoans. That is the famous malarial-causing protozoan. Okay, malaria, you know, it's the most infectious disease, dreadful disease affecting human beings. It is caused by protozoans, namely a very tiny protozoan, Plasmodium, is responsible for this malarial fever. You have different species of Plasmodium, that is Plasmodium vivax, Plasmodium malaria, Plasmodium falciparum. In this, falciparum causes all the four species, actually one more species is there, ovale, Plasmodium ovale, all these four species are supposed to cause malaria, but the dreadful of this is Plasmodium falciparum, which is causes malignant malaria, so it's most serious one and it can be fatal, sometimes. Okay, if we take the life cycle of malaria. Before that, we'll see that Plasmodium, picture of Plasmodium vivax and picture of falciparum, more or less the same, and malaria. This is a life cycle of malaria. This I will first, we'll see first the picture, then again we'll come back to this life cycle of malaria. This is also the protozoan causing malaria. Then we'll see, this is what the sporozoites. I'll give the explanation. We'll come again to the life cycle of malaria. Life cycle of malaria, it is, we'll see about the life cycle. You have a life cycle given in your book also. First of all, I'll explain. Then again, in the book, whatever life cycle they are given, that also we'll see. Here also the life cycle of malaria is given. Before that, you must know about how it causes the disease. See, this Plasmodium is given in the picture. Before that, I'll explain, then I will again explain the picture. it plasmodium that is it can be four species are there any species if it enters human being as spore they will be having this protozoans have different forms in their life cycle okay and they need a vector that is an important thing these all these protozoans they need a vector to complete their life cycle if the vector is not there they will not be able to complete their life cycle see they need a host body to complete the life cycle and this is the main is human host in which they cause total destruction not in the body of the mosquito so it enters a human being as sporozoids through a bite of an infected female anopheles mosquito this is I said already this is because of the mosquito will be having this protozoan okay the parasites initially multiply within the liver cell it enters the liver cells of human and then it multiplies and then attack from there it passes through blood attack the RBC RBC is a target organ resulting in the rupture of the RBC the rupture of the RBC is associated with the release of some toxin poison substance which is known as a hemozoin which is the mainly responsible see malaria means it will be fever accompanied with chill so that is mainly this toxic substance whenever it is released in the blood it is responsible for the chill and high fever recurring every 3 to 4 days so this is what they say malarial fever which is caused by the protozoan plasmodium to a vector that is a female anopheles mosquito here in the life cycle it's given actually it needs to complete its life cycle it needs two hosts one is the human being another is the mosquito the mosquito will not be affected you can see here once again I will show in the book also I will explain that life cycle also you can see the man how it comes the sporozoids you see in the picture and the sporozoids will be in the salivary gland of the mosquito it bites the infected mosquito bites a human being and inside the human being first of all the liver cells are attacked from the liver cell it is released to the blood and affects the RBC it multiplies and the ruptured RBC along with the toxin produced causes a fever and high chill what happens some of the sporozoids that is in the man they will undergo sexual reproduction they form gametocytes so they form gametocytes you know sexual reproduction male and female gametocytes and they will be inside the body of human being which will be again taken by another mosquito the same female anopheles mosquito when it sucks blood so these gametocytes will again develop inside the intestine of the mosquito the stomach wall in the intestine of the mosquito you know male and the female gametes fertilization takes place zygote formation after zygote formation it results in the sporozoids from there so after they have formed the sporozoids the young ones which stay in the stomach wall they come back to the salivary gland of the mosquito and they stay in the salivary gland of the mosquito when it bites and another healthy person the infected mosquito which is having the salivary gland sporozoids along when it's taking blood it will be injecting the sporozoids in the blood of a healthy man so he gets the infection so the cycle repeats like that so what happens here liver cells I said human being liver cell the parenchyma cells of the liver it attacks where they divide and forms actually sporozoids is given when they are in the liver they will be forming the, I said they have different forms in their life cycle when they are in the liver they form sporozoids and they are released when they are released from the liver they actually form one more another form known as merozoids which is actually the most infectious stage these merozoids only are released in the blood through RBC and they cause release in the blood these merozoids only cause rupture of the RBC and they produce a toxic substance so that is the most infective stage even sporozoids so many stages infective stages they will be having in the life cycle so the main thing is they need a vector if you control the vector you can control the plasmodium there is no life for the plasmodium if they don't find the body of the mosquito they don't get a mosquito they cannot complete their life cycle so asexual cycle is completed in the human, sexual cycle is completed in the body of the mosquito. So no vectors, the plasmodium will not be able to complete its life cycle, or you can say no life for that. So this is what the life cycle of malaria. Once again, I will show the picture which is given in the textbook also. Now you see the female Anopheles mosquito which causes malaria. These are the sporozoites, very tiny, it will be very tiny in your blood, most infectious thing. This is what the female Anopheles mosquito which causes malaria. You know, number of other diseases are there which are caused by various kinds of mosquito. You know, dengue, that is caused by this kind of mosquito, Aedes mosquito, which causes dengue, and flaviviruses, that is a kind of viruses. Flaviviruses causes dengue. This flaviviruses will be taken by this mosquito. Flaviviruses will be taken by this mosquito which causes dengue. Aedes mosquito and chikungunya, and one more we'll see, that is elephantiasis. When I will be coming again, I will show that picture. Now we'll see the life cycle which is given in your book. The same thing as I explained now, the life cycle. So you see the, when the mosquito, same thing, bites, another sporozoites are injected along with the bite of the female Anopheles mosquito. You can see the liver cell, the parasites reach the liver cell through the blood. Okay, this side you can see, and how the parasite again reproduce asexual, human host asexual and mosquito host sexual. Okay, in the liver cell, from the liver cell bursting the cell and released into the blood, released blood RBC is the target thing. It will be affecting the RBC along rupture of the RBC along with the release of the toxic substance hemozoin, that is responsible for fever and chill. So then some of the sporozoids, they form the gametocytes. Sexual stages gametocytes is given, that develop in the RBC itself. Some of the forms will develop in the RBC as gametocytes, male and the female, and these gametocytes will be waiting for the mosquito to be so the female mosquito takes up the gametocytes with blood meal, and what happens inside the mosquito intestine or the stomach, they undergo fertilization and development takes place in the mosquito's intestine, and again you can see they will be released as sporozoites after the development, and they will be they are the infective stages. They escape from the intestine and migrate to the salivary glands in the of the mosquitoes, and then this mosquito again it bites a human being along with the blood. It will be injecting millions of these sporozoids. So this is what the life cycle. So to control this disease, we have to control the vector, not the protozoan. So next we are going to see is about amoebiasis. This is also a protozoan, entangled by Histolytica. And we'll first of all we'll see a picture of this Entamoeba histolytica. This is also a protozoan parasite. This is what the picture of Entamoeba histolytica, which causes amoebiasis or amoebic dysentery. See, this Entamoeba histolytica is the name of the protozoan parasite. It causes amoebiasis or amoebic dysentery, and it leaves the large intestine of man or human. Symptoms are constipation, abdominal pain and cramps, stool with this is what the very important symptom, stool motion with excess mucus and blood clots. If this is there, you can say it is due to amoebiasis. Mechanical carrier, houseflies, you know very well. Houseflies are everywhere. The body is hairy and they carry thousands of pathogenic microorganisms. So wherever they sit, they drop these pathogens and they contaminate water, food, wherever, whatever. Okay, so here it's nothing but the houseflies. Mode of transmission, they transmit the parasites from the feces of the infected, that is a stool motion of the infected person to food and food products by which it is contaminated, and the next person will get the infection. This is about Entamoeba aegypti, which is a protozoan parasite. Next we'll see about ascariasis. This is a nematode worm, ascariasis. They are the common round worms. Afterwards I'll show the picture. First I will give the explanation. They are intestinal parasites, common round worms, nematodes you can say. Causative agent, Ascaris lambricoides. You have pictures, male and the female. Pictures afterwards I'll show. You the symptoms we'll see. Internal bleeding, muscular pain, fever, anemia, blockage of the intestinal passage. See this because when the number of infection is more severe, only intestine blockage of the intestinal passage you will get, and internal bleeding. This is also severity of the infection, because this ascariasis, you know very well, it is a endoparasite, so it will be having a special modification, suckers and all, which it will that intestine it will cause damage, that will lead to internal bleeding if it is too much, because of the severity of the infection. Mode of transmission, the eggs of the parasite are excreted along with the feces of the infected person in the motion. It will be excreted, which contaminates soil, water, plants, etc. So a healthy person acquires this infection through contaminated water, vegetable, fruits contaminated with this kind of cyst, eggs that is fruits, etc. So this and all we have to follow, we have to keep our surroundings inside and outside and all very clean to avoid this kind of infections. So that's all about ascariasis, which is the intestinal. We see now some of the pictures related to this roundworm infection. I will show the picture of ascariasis. This is what I said, all it will be, just imagine it will be in the inside. By taking medicines, it will come out along with the motion. This is a female and male. And next one, this is the picture of the next one, elephantiasis or filariasis. Elephant eye, both are same. This is what the picture of this is also in this also mosquito access vector, Culex mosquito. That mosquitoes all vectors are female, male will not cause any harm, or they are not they don't carry any pathogen. All the vector borne diseases, especially mosquito, all are female. In the case of dengue and malaria, chikungunya, all are female only. This also caused by elephantiasis, filariasis caused by Culex mosquito. You can see the mosquito, and these are filarial worms, two species, Eucheria brancoftii and Eucheria malayi, both causes elephantiasis by the bite of female mosquito vectors, nothing but the Culex. The name of the mosquito is Culex. This also where sanitation is very poor, that kind of area people will get open drainage, this kind of infection. Now we'll see what is see, causative agent, elephantiasis or filariasis. Causative agent, Eucheria brancoftii, Eucheria malayi, filarial worms. The target organs, even the lymphatic vessels of the lower limbs, lower limb of a human being. See, they cause excessive damage to the leg, that is affect the cutaneous and subcutaneous tissue of the legs. And genital organs are also affected, resulting in gross deformities, that is malfunction of the organs. They live for so many years. Okay, mode of transmission, pathogen transmitted to a healthy person through the bite of the female mosquito vector, that is what we saw in the picture, Culex. Only through the bite they will be having effects on the host body. Chronic, prolonged chronic inflammation of the organs on which they live for many years, and they cause, we'll now see the picture of this. See, you can see that I already said it will be affecting the cutaneous and subcutaneous tissues of the leg. They leave there, affect the lymphatic system, is an immune thing which produces immune cells. This is a picture, the book also it's given, but this picture is also, you can see how it is affected, where sanitation is very poor, open drainage and all, this kind of infection you can see. Now, filariasis, this is what filariasis or elephantiasis. And then we'll see about the fungal infections. Fungal infections, now we'll see some pictures, then I will give the infection, explanation. Commonly known as ringworm infections. There are three genera, Trichophyton, Microsporum and Epidermophyton. All these collectively known as dermatophytes. Dermatophytes, they are commonly caused as ringworm infections. And these are the structure of this fungus. You know, body is hyphae, septa, they have the normal structure of fungus. And this is what in the book also picture is there. You can see this ringworm infection on the skin near the chin. And the next picture also, this is what easily communicable. If you use the belongings of the infected person, it is easily communicable. Now again back to this we'll go see the three genera, Microsporum, Trichophyton, Epidermophyton. What are the symptoms? Appearance of dry scaly lesions. The lesions means on the skin, you saw it will not be like bruises, it will not be very smooth. Inflammation of the tissues. Okay, that is what the meaning for that lesions. Okay, inflammation of the skin tissues on various parts of the body, such as skin, nails and scalp. Okay, so abnormal tissue, always a inflammation of a tissue, you can say. That's change, a structural change in the tissue. I just want to know meaning for lesions. Then effects on the skin. Lesions are accompanied by intense itching. They'll have itching. Okay, then heat and moisture help these fungus to live in skin folds such as groin or between the toes. You know, between the toes. Groin, it's area below the abdomen, between the thigh, below the thigh. That region is a groin where you have a heat and moisture. So that will help this fungus to grow. So then mode of transmission, as I said, is a very infectious and acquired from soil or by using a towel, cloth or even comb of an infected person. Easily it will come if you use the belongings of an infected person. So that is a thing of fungal infection. Effects on the skin we saw, symptoms and other things and all we saw. So I think we have covered almost all the diseases. Now, to avoid all this kind of disease, what are the things you have to follow? That is very, very important. Okay, first one is personal hygiene. Personal hygiene, whatever personal hygiene is very important, then we'll see about the public hygiene. See, mostly in the case of this vector-borne diseases and all, you have to control the vector. So that is very, very important. We'll see first personal hygiene. Keeping the body clean and consumption of clean drinking water, that is very, very important. Food, vegetable and fruits, whatever you buy, even water, you just boil it nicely, boil the water to kill the pathogenic microorganisms, because mainly through water a number of infectious diseases spreads. So this is very, very important. Always drink pure water, clean drinking water consumption. It's very important. And food also very, very important. Okay, it should not be contaminated. And public hygiene, that is generally public hygiene, general things, water, proper disposal of waste and excreta, that is very, very important. That everybody knows. And periodic cleaning and disinfection of water reservoirs, pools and tanks, etc. Periodically you have to always, through that a number of infectious diseases spread. Cesspools is nothing but temporary storage for liquid waste and other sewage, which has to be cleaned and disinfected. That is very, very important. This is a public hygiene general rules you can follow, the general things I can say. Then if it is a waterborne disease, you have to be more careful. That is standard practices of hygiene in public catering. So in public catering, you have to follow some hygienic ways. Why? Because this waterborne diseases drop infectious agents that are transmitted through food and water. So public catering and all, in a very hygienic manner, it has to be done so that they can avoid this kind of infectious agents which easily spread through food and water. If they are not doing it in a hygienic way, the food and the water gets contaminated and the people will be affected. So that is very, very important. If it is a case of waterborne disease, if it is airborne disease, direct contact with the infected person or their belongings should be avoided. That is what very, very important in the case of airborne diseases. Okay, then if it is a airborne disease, I already said the controlling the vector is very, very important rather than controlling the pathogen, which we cannot. Because once you control the vector, the pathogen dies automatically, because it needs to complete its life cycle, it needs a host. So eliminate or control the vector and the breeding place, so that is very, very important. Open drainage or anywhere stagnant water, cover it. Okay, avoid stagnation of water in and around residential areas, very important, your surroundings. Regular cleaning of household coolers, that also you'll get infection. Use of mosquito nets, that everybody knows, and spraying of insecticides in ditches, drainage, swamps, etc. to avoid the breeding places of mosquito. Introducing, this is a very all wells and in wells, whoever has got wells and all, they will introduce this kind of larvivorous fishes like Gambusia in ponds also to control mosquito larvae. They will eat the larvae of the mosquito so that it'll get protected against this kind of mosquito. Here you can see a picture of Gambusia. These are larvivorous fishes which will eat the mosquito larvae. So it can be introduced in wells, ponds, tanks and all. So that to control the vector, and doors and windows should be provided with a wire mesh to protect the entry of mosquitoes that inside our house and our surroundings, very, very important. And drainage area, all the bins should be very clean to avoid this kind of infections. And then nowadays, apart from that, keeping all these area clean, apart from that, vaccination is there. The use of vaccines and immunization programs have enabled us to completely eradicate deadly diseases like smallpox. Now we have almost it's eradicated. That is mainly because of the use of vaccine and immunization program. That is a modern technology. And other diseases like polio, diphtheria, pneumonia and tetanus also have been controlled by the use of vaccines. And in biotech, the field of biotechnology also, they are just introducing newer and safer vaccines for the public. And even after, I mean, number of antibiotics and number of new drugs also have been created to control this kind of infectious diseases. And number of infectious diseases number have come down because of the use of powerful antibiotics and drugs. I think I've made you clear with almost all these things. So the next class we'll see about immunity, what are the kinds of immunity, other things and all. And you kindly read what and all I've said now. Okay children, thank you, have a good day.